want to bring water, bring friends who will carry you down when you pass out. I am not joking, okay? And what you can do is go up on the bus, and then we'll sort of wander off. There's a million trails up there. If you want to do something simple, I know at least one of the local guys said, I don't want to go to the top of Green Mountain because my ankle hurts from the foot race. Okay, there are flat trails. If you think you are tough, see me at one of the breaks, because I know a real killer hike up there. I've done 90% of that killer hike, and I'm turning 67, okay? So if you think you're tough, you see me. But I'm not going to take everybody there, because I don't feel like tough this weekend, okay? I'm going to go up on Green Mountain and then come down, okay? So that's what we'll do. So I'm going to be there at 8:30 on Sunday saying, let's get on the bus, and we'll send people up there, and we'll sort of organize it, and it'll sort of be chaotic. And you can come back whenever you want to, because the bus will be running, okay? So that's Sunday. And bring lunch. What else? Did I leave anything out? Okay, ask me questions at the break, because we have more important things to do now, okay? So.
All right. Thanks, Tom. So, where I stayed yesterday, I gave you this overview on how to motivate the ADS-CFT correspondence from looking at D3 brains. And so the thing which remains to be added is to do the whole thing at finer temperature, which also has some very nice features, as I'm going to show. And to really appreciate this from the brain side, let's remind us of just one or two features of finite temperature field theory. So of course this is a huge field, and I can't do it any justice here. Just let me state very quickly that when you are in equilibrium, so for now I'm going to consider the case when you consider equilibrium. Of course, there's also many interesting things going on when you're out of equilibrium. Then you can use something called the imaginary time formalism. And so essentially you can calculate an ensemble average and this looks as follows. So you take the trace over the matrix exponent of minus beta h, where h is the Hamiltonian of your system, and then you normalize by the density of states, and then here's your operator. Okay, so and this beta, setting the Boltzmann constant to 1, this is 1 over the temperature, and this, of course, very much looks like something you could do in Minkowski space, but of course we have set the temperature you obtained from making the time imaginary. So formally, beta is an imaginary time. Okay, and then there's an important analyticity property of the thermal Green's functions. And this implies this requires that this imaginary, so you take, this is your ordinary time, and you introduce imaginary time in this way, and then these analyticity properties of the thermal Green's functions imply that tau is constrained to be in the interval between 0 and beta, and this implies that tau is compactified on a circle. Okay. So this is just a quick reminder of one of the essential features of this number field theory. Okay, so keeping this in mind, let's now turn to the gravity dual thermodynamics. And since we are again going to consider these three brains, this will be NX24 super young waves at finite temperature, but I should express right away that when you switch on the finite temperature, then the supersymmetry is actually going to be broken. So there's a breaking of the supersymmetry. And here we'll just consider the case that we stay on R3. So this means we will have a black brain instead of a black hole. Okay. And let me stress, so the compactification of time of this tor breaks supersymmetry. And in particular, you have to have antiperiodic boundary conditions for the fermions on the circle. Good. This also implies that the bosonic field will actually not be protected along anymore against quantum corrections, and they will become massive, and so that's where the breaking of D'Souza comes from. Okay, and so what we will have on the gravity side will be the thermodynamics of so-called black D3 brains. And so let me write the metric of those. So we have the same H of R as we had yesterday. So, and this is before taking the near horizon limits. Again, this will be this 1 plus A to the fourth over R to the fourth. And now we have this additional blackening factor. So writing it for the real time in Minkowski space, and this will look like this. And so if I put a vector on the x, these are the R3 directions, which are in ADS-CFT later will be parallel to the boundary. And then we have our six transversal directions. And here's our 5 sphere. Okay, so this blackening factor, the question? F of R will just be 1 minus RH over R to the fourth, where this RH will be your Schwarzschild radius of this black grain. And as before, we have this function H, which is this harmonic function, which comes from the type 2B supergravity equations of motion. And this looks like that. Okay, and now we take the near horizon limit as yesterday, and we go to Euclidean time as on that blackboard. So when you do that, then you get this metric as follows. The A squared is A squared over Z squared, where Z is the same. So again, so we write that R is, or Z is A squared over R. And then here we have our blackening factor, z to the fourth over zh to the fourth, d tau. Now here this is the Euclidean time, and then dx squared, and here we have 1 over 1 minus z to the fourth over zh to the fourth dz squared, and finally the 5 sphere. All right. Okay, so this dh is your Schwarzschild ranges. Okay, so this is very similar for a black hole, except that these directions are extended in these R3 directions, and this means we don't have a black hole but a black brain. And similarly to the black hole, we know that the tau tau component goes to zero, and the zz component goes to infinity when the radial coordinate approaches the Schwarzschild horizon. Okay, so to make the connection to the thermal field theory, what we're going to do is to introduce a further radial variable. And so this will be defined by this equation. So this is this rho is the new variable, and so this is a measure of for the distance from the horizon. Which is at z8. And so now we expand our metric in this row, so to lowest order in row. So we expand essentially around the horizon, and then the Euclidean metric becomes so the following, the s squared is 4 rho squared over zh squared d tau squared plus a squared over zh squared dx squared plus d rho squared. Okay, so so now let's study this metric, and let's look just at the coordinates spanning so the tau and rho directions. And oh, sorry, sorry about this. Yeah. So then we just look at these two directions, and we introduce a new variable phi, which we define to be 2 tau over z8. And then, so I should say, define this, and then we have, in this tau rho direction, we get the metric the s squared is equal to d rho squared plus rho squared d phi squared. Okay, so what is the space described by this metric? Okay, it's just a plane, okay, but you have to be careful. Under which condition is this a plane? Yeah, yeah, okay, very good, very good, very good. So, if phi doesn't go from 0 to 2 pi, then you get a conical singularity, okay, and then the space is not regular. So so for regularity at rho equal to 0, so at the horizon, we must have that pi, this phi goes from 0 to 2 pi. Okay? And now we can calculate back. If we have this phi, then now we use this relation and see that what this implies for tau. And so this implies that the period of tau is delta tau, which is pi times z8. And so from the field theory, this is what I wrote on the very first blackboard, we know that this delta tau is actually beta. And since we set the Boltzmann constant to 1, this is 1 over tau, 1 over the temperature. Okay. And so essentially what we have now done is that we can now insert this into this relation, and then we find a relation between the Schwarzschild horizon and the temperature in the field theory. But at the same time, of course, this defines the Hawking temperature of the black hole. So what we have done is that the field theory temperature is identified with the Hawking temperature of the black hole. I should better say of the black brain. Okay, so this is very interesting. So we know that we have this black brain solution, and so we have seen that we can identify this with a finite temperature field theory in the dual field theory side. And okay, so this is a very nice connection and allows a lot of beautiful physics. In particular, I should mention that so far I did everything in equilibrium because we used this Euclidean approach, and this I will stick with this today. But you can now also, instead of using this imaginary time formalism, introduce a so-called real-time formalism, and there's the so-called Schwinger-Keldysh approach for ensemble field theory. And then you can actually study small fluctuations about equilibrium and study transport properties. And so this has lots of wonderful applications also in the context of gauge gravity duality. Unfortunately, I won't have time to talk about all of these about all of those, but I will give you some examples. But now, for now, let's stick with this imaginary time formalism with the Euclidean case, because there's one very short and beautiful calculation which we can do, and this is to calculate the entropy of this black brain. And so that's what I would like to show to you now. Okay, so now we compute the QFT entropy So the entropy of the dual field theory, so of the QFT dual to the black brain, from the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of this black brain itself. And so I should mention that this is a famous calculation of Igor, and I will give you the reference. So, and actually it's interesting to note that this was done before the ADS-CFT correspondence, so this is Gupta, Klebanov, and Pete, 1996. So, so the Bekenstein-Hawking entropy, as you know, is given by the area of the horizon divided by 4 times the Newton constant. And so, so here now this A will be the area of the black brain horizon. Okay, so let's calculate this. And okay, so this area is given by, so we have to integrate over these 3 directions at the boundary. And then we have square root of the determinant of the 3D metric at the Schwarzschild horizon. And then for the other 10 dimensions, there's still the volume of the S5, which we can just, so this integral we can do very quickly, we don't have to write it explicitly, and so this is equal to pi cube times L to the fifth. Okay, and now we have to calculate this determinant, and so this determinant in 3D, because the metric is diagonal, is just the product of the 3 diagonal entries, and this you can do very quickly. And so in the near horizon, the limit is just that. Okay, and so then we have to insert this into here and do this integral. And so that's not so difficult to do. And so the result is that A is equal to pi to the 6th, L to the 8th, t cubed. So the t cubed is very important because that's how the entropy is going to scale. So this is already reassuring that we find this. And then the volume of the R3, we have, of course, this is an infinite volume, but so we could think of a density later by dividing by this volume, for instance. Okay, so and now, so this was just doing this integral, and now we have to get all the, so we have to use this formula, and so we have to express G Newton in our ADS-CFT variables. And so for this now we note the following, that the 5-dimensional Newton constant will be given by the 10-dimensional Newton constant divided by the volume of the S5. And then now if you use various relations of ADS-CFT, which I introduced yesterday, you get that this is pi over 2 L cubed over N squared. And for this, use that the Newton constant in 10 dimensions, which in this other notation is written as 16 pi g10. And so as I showed yesterday, or I mentioned yesterday from string theory, this is 2 pi to the 7 alpha prime to the 4th gs squared. And then yesterday we integrated the flux of the S5 over the F5 flux over this S5, which bounds the 6-dimensional volume. And this calculation gave us this super important relation in ADS-CFT that we have this relation here. Okay. And now, so I can just take all these relations and plug everything in. And then the final result is that the entropy of the black hole is given by pi cubed over 2 n squared t cubed volume of r to the 3. Okay, so this is a beautiful result. So because in our everything is in the adjoint representation in our NX24 theory, so even if the supersymmetry is broken, we should still keep this n squared scaling. The t cubed is nice for because that's what you expect for an entropy in a 3+1 dimensional field theory. And okay, then we have this volume here. And so this is a super nice and interesting result, and it becomes even more interesting if you now compare to the same calculation in a free field theory. So obviously, since we used ADS-CFT, this is supposed to hold a strong coupling. Okay, so let me emphasize that this is a strong coupling result. Since we use strong coupling, since we used ADS-CFT. And now some people actually did a free field theory calculation with the field, the fields of NX24 superangles. And there the result is S is equal to 2 pi squared over 3 n cubed t to the 3 volume of the R3. Okay, so it's almost the same, except that this factor differs by a factor of 3/4. So, so the strongly coupled result is smaller by a factor of 3/4 than the original result. And okay, so this is very nice, and so this clearly shows that there's a renormalization going on. And so at weak coupling, then we have a different result from strong coupling. So the scaling and the dependence on the temperature, everything is the same, but this pre-factor will actually change. So there's really an interpolation between the free theory and the strongly coupled theory result. And but it is very impressive that just putting together all these relations which we derived yesterday, that you can get such a simple and beautiful expression. Do you want to comment anything on this?
People also look at, for example,
okay, so Igor said, okay, so he was mentioning that people calculated corrections to the free field theory result in perturbation theory, and it tends to correct the result in the correct direction. So it really seems to be an interpolating flow between the free field and the strong coupling result. Okay, so I think this is a very nice and beautiful example. I mean, this wasn't a very complicated calculation, and it's very profound, and I really like this a lot. Good.
So no one has managed to extrapolate from weak to strong coupling in field theory. So
okay.
So the problem of really establishing the 3/4.
Yeah. Okay. So Igor says it's not solved how to establish the 3/4 in the field theory side. So this is yet unsolved problem. Good. Okay. So this was my brief introduction to equilibrium thermodynamics in ADS-CFT, and as I mentioned, if you now go to the non-equilibrium case and you can study transport properties, and this is a huge area in applications also of gauge gravity duality, and I'm sure you will hear more about this during the school. Well, this is it's first of all, it's just dimensional analysis, okay, so if you just count the dimensions of the entropy, that's what you should get.
It's a CFT, but T is the whole.
Yeah.
There's nothing else.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's no sphere here.
No, the sphere is in the gravity side, not on the field theory side. The sphere, so you see, I tried it, the sphere disappears because, so the point is that the sphere, where is my sphere? Yes, okay, well, but that's a reasonable assumption. It's, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So of course it enters that the entropy is extensive. Yeah, that's certainly true. But okay, so just to make clear, so this volume of the S5 only appears on the gravity side, but you actually need this L to cancel the L's which appear in the Newton constant. Okay, so this will actually cancel and gives you the prefactor of the calculation. So there will be no L in the final result. Okay, this is important. Okay. Yeah? Well, okay, but some other people were surprised that it's different. So the question is it surprising that you know the strong coupling result is so close to the free result? Well, I mean, since we can't really calculate this quantity yet in the field theory side, it's very hard to say what you really expect. So, I mean, I think it's interesting that it's smaller. I mean, the strongly coupled case. It's an interesting observation. Yeah, here.
There's another case where the n-scaling changes, right? And it's supposed to be dual to confine. Calculate the entropy on a strong coupling.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So here, this is for the conformal case,
saying that
yeah.
It's not always true that it's going to be like that same functional form in all the variables and just maybe three factors.
No, no, but here I just said I start with a CFT and I break just by introducing a finer temperature. But of course, if you want to run to a confining theory, then lots of other things will happen. There was another question. No, I don't think I wouldn't claim I expect it to be monotonic. I expect it to be continuous in some way. I mean, there should be some kind of flow. But this is, of course, a physical expectation. It's not any. I can't do a calculation to prove that this is true. Yeah. I think it's an observation, but it's a very nice observation. Yeah, yeah. So this was Igor was mentioning. You can do perturbative corrections to this result and see that the result will be smaller than the free one. So this is okay. Anything else?
The discussion of decoupling corrections actually is in my 1999
dissection. Okay. So for
maybe Oliver remembers that.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so look at Igor's 1999 Tazi notes. Good. Okay, so now let me move on to something else, well, which is closely related, of course, but so now I gave you this introduction to various facts, and I thought it would be nice to show you an application example, which is a little closer to my own current research, and where we can see all the concepts are introduced at work in some pretty recent example. And so this example which I would like to show to you is a holographic dual of the so-called Kondo model. So the Kondo model is a model from condensed matter physics which has been around for quite a while, but it's of interest for a number of reasons which I will enumerate to you now. And okay, so now let's turn to this holographic Kondo model. So first let me explain what the Kondo model is, and then I'll show you how to construct a gravity dual using all the techniques which we have considered. Okay, so what's the Kondo model describing? So what you consider is a magnetic impurity, for instance in some conductor, which is coupled to the surrounding conduction electrons. And in the very simplest example, you would take these to just be free except for the coupling to this impurity. But later, of course, in ADS-CFT, these will be strongly coupled among themselves before you actually couple them to this impurity. Okay, so why would this be interesting? Well, there's a huge amount of reasons. So the first point is that, as I'm going to show to you, this Kondo model has some similarities to low-energy QCD. So as we know, low-energy QCD is strongly coupled, and it's not known how to solve it. And so here you can view this as some interesting toy model, which maybe can tell you something about strongly coupled theories in the infrared. So there's a similarity to low energy QCD. I will explain this more. Okay, then there's a very nice large N limit which we will see. And so this limit will, okay, so obviously in condensed matter context, most of the time this magnetic impurity is an SU2 representation, or a representation of SU2, but you can make this in representation of SUN. And this is something which people have actually studied in condensed matter physics and solved this Kondo problem this way. And so it's another very beautiful example of a large N limit, which I would like to show to you. Then this model actually will involve some double trace operators, which I think also appeared already during the course of the week. And so this will be a nice example where you actually have a double trace operator. Well, there's only one, so I shouldn't put an S, which will generate a renormalization group flow leaving this conformal fixed point. And so this is, I think, also nice in the context of things we have seen. Then I should say you can reduce this model to a model in 1+1 dimensions. And so there have been some very nice studies of these models in the context of CFT. So that also ties in very nicely with what's going on this week. And in particular, here we have a renormalization group flow which connects a UV and an IR fixed point. So we can break the conformal symmetry in a controlled way and flow from one fixed point to another one. And okay, so then actually this model makes use of some techniques of applied holography, which I'm sure will appear also during the course of the school. And here, therefore, I will just mention him very briefly. As I just said, there will be an holographic example of a renormalization group flow. But then we will also have a condensation taking place, which I also want to show to you. So it's something similar to a so-called holographic superconductor in the space ADS2. Okay, so this will serve as an important ingredient in this holographic Kondo model. And then you can actually calculate the entanglement entropy. So this, I don't think I will have time to show to you, but and I think this will also be discussed later during the week. And here there's also some very nice comparison possible between the gravity side and the field theory side, where you get matching results. And then you can study quantum quenches. So you introduce a time dependence of the coupling, and that also gives some very interesting structures, especially as far as the late time behavior is concerned. Okay, so that's already a lot of motivation. There's even more. So in particular, there's a relation to the famous SYK model, which I'm sure you will also hear about next week. So if you haven't seen this, this refers to Sachdev, Yi, and Kitayev. And so maybe already here at the stage, if you're wondering what the relation is, so what we will actually do, okay, we will have a spin field in our model, which in our case describes the magnetic impurity. And in the large N limit, as I will show to you, it turns out it's very useful to write this in terms of two auxiliary fermions. In such a way, so you choose some appropriate representation of the SUN spin group, and then you introduce these fermions chi. And okay, so they a name which they're called by in condensed matter physics is Avril-Kozov pseudo fermions. So this is just a name. I will explain what they do. And the connection to the SYK, so in our case, these will be extremely important to provide a large N limit in which you can see the coupling between these fields and the electrons. But what actually Sachdev and Yi did in 1993, so this is already a long time ago again, so they wrote the Ising model, which of course also involves spin operators in terms of these chi, and then you do some averaging, and that gives you the Sachdev Yi model. And so that model, so you actually reduce by this averaging, you reduce from an Ising model with lots of sites to just a single site. It's a kind of mean field theory at a single site. And so here in that model, these extra fermions, they will actually be Weyl fermions. And so the addition of Kitayev was to write these Weyl fermions in terms of, replace them by Majorana fermions. However, in this Kondo model context, I will stay with these Weyl fermions here, because then there's actually a spurious U1 symmetry which you introduce here, and this we will actually need for our model. Okay, but I think it's interesting to keep in mind that this model has some relations to that model, and some of the features we will encounter are potentially also very relevant in that context. Okay, yeah. No. Sorry. so this is a representation. Okay, so this is a representation of SUN. Okay, and so now if you take the limit where n gets very large, and you have this product of two of these, so say SA times SA, and then you replace these SA by this operator, then you have four of these fermions. Remember, in the Sachdev Yi model, there's actually a product of four fermions. But then you will use a Fiertz identity to evaluate the product of the two matrices. And so in the large N limit, actually, this will just give you one term, and you just get a simple construction of the fermions. So the J's, they, of course, appear because if you have your Hamiltonian of the Ising model, then you have some coupling like this, okay. But I didn't talk about this J at all. I just talked about this, and you just take this S and you write it in this form. Then you multiply two of them together, and in the large N limit, you can evaluate the product of the two T's which you have, and so the T's will disappear from the discussion in the large N limit. But this I will show in more detail later. Okay, but good question. Okay, so of course, the most beautiful thing of this all is that this is really a model which is of experimental significance. Okay, so people studying quantum dots, for instance, they use this Kondo model. And of course, the original model is from 1964, so this is really ancient, but still in condensed matter physics, there's a lot of renewed interest in various circumstances. So let me just write this down. I'm going to write down the Hamiltonian in 1 minute, and then so you will see where everything is. Okay, let me just make this one point that is of experimental relevance. So the final motivation is of experimental relevance in condensed matter, and so mostly currently this is in relation to so-called quantum dots. And okay, so if I get there tomorrow, I'm going to tell you something about so-called Fano resonances. And so this is a particular asymmetric form of the spectral function which you can calculate using holographic techniques. And these actually show up in the quantum dot as well. So I think there's a lot of possibilities of doing something interesting here. Okay, on my sheet there's now a list of references of recent papers, but I will just put this online and you can read them there. Okay, so now what's the Hamiltonian of this model? So let me just first start with the original SU2 condo model, which is from June Kondo in 1964. And okay, so this was designed to explain some experimental fact, but it already at that time it was really decisive for the development of the RG, for the renormalization group, and lots of developments in quantum field theory were actually triggered by this. And so, as I said, we consider a magnetic impurity interacting with a free electron gas. And so the simplest case is that the spin is in a representation of SU2 and the electrons are also in a representation of SU2. So the electron spin, so this is the impurity spin, and the electron spin is also an SU2 spin. Okay, then I can write a Hamiltonian. And okay, so this is this is the Fermi velocity over 2 pi I, and then we have some electrons denoted by psi. And okay, so I should say right away that we just write the model in two dimensions. So one dimension is time and one dimension is space, and this space dimension here is usually denoted by R. And then so this is just the kinetic term for the electrons. So they are just essentially free. However, then there will be an interaction which is localized in space. Maybe I should call this x. And then when x is equal to 0, we have an interaction which again involves the Fermi velocity. And then there's a coupling called lambda k. So I will call this coupling lambda k as well, but you shouldn't confuse this with the TUF coupling, because later it's a bit unfortunate because this is also lambda, but so later we will consider the case that lambda k times n will be fixed, which in that case will be our analog of the TUF coupling. And n will go to infinity. Okay, but that's for later. And so the interaction now is that so this vector now is a vector in spin space, and so this will couple to some current of the electrons. And okay, so the current for the electrons you can essentially write as psi dagger tau psi, where this is a vector of Pauli matrices. Okay, and then obviously this will satisfy an SU2 algebra. Yes, so they are essentially vial fermions. Yeah. Okay, so the algebra is that.
1 plus 1 in front of the 0. If you think of
it. Yeah. Yes, I think you can. Yeah. Sure. So the only point is, I mean, there's a U1 symmetry here. Okay, so this is your standard SU2 algebra in spin space, so these ABC are in spin space. So why did Kondo propose this model? Because he, with this, he actually solved an experimental problem. So this describes the following experimental fact. So I really like that. So this was a model which was designed to explain something in the experiment, but then it developed a whole life in theoretical physics as a general kind of toy model for many important things. And I think this is a very nice connection here. So here you have the temperature, and here you have the resistivity. And so this is zero. And so when you have a metal, in principle here you have some linear behavior. And then when there's impurities around which are magnetic, actually it grows again here. And if you have impurities which are just which are non-magnetic, it would just go to a constant. Okay, so then so these are the spin impurities. They have this rise. So this can really be seen in measurements of, say, iron or something like this. And this is impurities without spin. Okay. So and this was for a long time this was a mystery how to describe this in a theory, and that's what Kondo solved. Okay. So the resistivity grows at very low temperature. Sorry?
Why did you say the metal?
Well, no, I'm saying I'm considering a metal, and then I'm cooling it down. And then when you get to very low temperatures, the resistivity does that, if you have magnetic impurities. Okay? Okay. And so, and it grows logarithmically. Okay, so this is like a log of 1 over t. Sorry, where are you? I didn't. Yes? Ah, the Fermi velocity. Vf is the Fermi velocity. Yeah, you can set this. You can set this to one. I mean, okay. So this is just to, you know, get. I mean, this is really from kind of matter of physics. So it's really saying you are at the Fermi surface. But I mean, for any practical calculation later on, I will just set this to one. Okay. Good. Okay. So the point is, of course, you should do this in three dimensions. But if you have just a single impurity and you just look at S wave scattering, you can effectively reduce this to a problem in 1+1 dimensions. As I already did, okay, and this is the so-called S-wave approximation, so there will be no higher order scattering waves. Yes, well, okay, of course, you know, I'm a theoretical physicist, so I didn't write this down, but this is, okay, this is... Okay, just take, in the original paper of Kondo, there's a graph of this for iron, gold, and various other methods. And people just cool this down, and so this is really very low temperatures, okay? And okay, but I can't tell you now how low they were. But it's okay, so it's in the order of a few Kelvin, okay? So it's really low, okay? Sorry, I should have looked this up. Good. So this is certainly well below room temperature, okay? Yeah. Yeah, it should be squared. I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah, it's okay. it should be a square at some point. But all of this is not relevant. The irrelevant part is this, okay? The relevant part is that it actually rises at low temperatures. That's what we're talking about in this
moment. Is still way higher than superconducting?
Yeah, this has nothing to do with superconductivity. No, okay. This is just an ordinary metal, an ordinary conductor, and you cool it down, and there's some magnetic impurities, and then it just goes up. But certainly, this is above the temperature where iron becomes superconducting. This has nothing to do with superconductivity. I mean, certainly in superconductivity, the resistivity should go down, not up.
I'm just saying that this will not go like what T at zero temperature. It will be some other transition.
Well, but okay, in the resolution of these experiments, okay, so this is something extremely simple. Just take a wire of iron and just cool it. Yeah, okay, so it's really super simple. And since your iron is not pure, there will be these magnetic impurities. This will give this rise. Okay, I will look up until tomorrow at which temperature this happens. I think then everybody, I'm surprised that everybody cares about numbers in this. Yeah. No. Okay. Let me show now. Okay. So, no. It's just we will just use a standard field theory. So I wrote Lagrangian over there. So you have these three fermions, and then you have this coupling, which is just a coupling at the point. But now we can use a so what Kondo did was to do a perturbative calculation, which involves a Feynman diagram. And he actually, just by doing this, you get this rise. So that's what I'm going to show to you now. So it's, you know, this model is from 1964, okay? It's a super standard. At the moment, there's no mystery. It will become much more exciting once we take to the large end of it. But so here, I'm just trying to give you some very basics. Okay. Yes, it's a local interaction. So the interaction is, so you have these electrons which are in the space, and just at one single point in your space that it will interact with the spin. Okay, so later this is like a defect. This is very important. Okay, so we have this. Yeah, the vector, so this A is an index in SU2 space, but it's you know, this impurity spin sits at the origin of real space. Okay, yeah? No, this is just the point. The impurity just sits there. It doesn't have any kinetic term. It doesn't move. Yes, and that's, okay, it's excellent that you ask all these questions. I think I'm about to answer all of them, but it's precisely what I want to explain to you now. Okay, very good. So, so as I said, so we look only at, S-wave scattering, okay, so this means no angular dependence. And this means, so the problem, so which really is normally, I have an impurity which sits in space, so space has three dimensions, and then I have time, reduces dimensions to a problem in 1+1 dimension. Okay. And so then I can introduce polar coordinates, and these coordinates will be r, which is the spatial coordinate, and t, which is time, okay? And then the point is that, okay, so you can imagine, so my spin sits here at some point, so this is the origin, and in the origin my radial coordinate starts, so which is obviously a positive coordinate. And so then now you can use a standard technique of conformal field theory. So So you have left and right movers. Okay, so you have left movers and right movers along this line, because you can write the equation of motion in this way. And so what you can now do, which is a trick which is often used in CFT, you just analytically continue to negative R, and these right movers, they get flipped to left movers at negative radius. Okay. So and so this is a standard technique in conformal field theory. So essentially, this defect will boil down to introducing a defect in your conformal field theory, if you want. So analytically continue. To negative values of R and flip the right mover, so phi, this will become, so, and then you have only chiral fermions in the Lagrangian. Okay, and so now what Kondo did was to calculate the resolutivity of first order in perturbation theory. And the result of the relevant Feynman graph, which she has to. So essentially, what you do, so here's your impurity, and that only propagates in time. Okay, it just sits there and time passes. Okay, and then here's your radial direction, and then an electron of some momentum k comes in, and so here there's this interaction term lambda k, and it bounces off twice. And so you have twice the coupling here, and then it goes off again. Okay, this is your Feynman graph, and the result of the calculation is.
What is the mass?
What is the mass?
Mass.
No, okay, so I'm just saying, okay, this impurity propagates in time, and this is your electron, which is in one higher dimension. So it goes to where the impurity is, it interacts with the impurity, it goes off again. It returns to the impurity and interacts again, because you want a loop here, okay? And then it just goes off again.
Why
is there?
Why is the return?
Because this is my Feynman diagram. I choose this. This is the Feynman diagram I want to compute. Yeah, yeah. I'm just writing a Feynman diagram which I want to compute, a one-loop Feynman diagram. The only thing is that your interaction only takes place at zero, okay? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Then at higher orders, you have multiple bounces, or you can also have things going in circles. I mean, okay. But then, okay, I just want to show the very simple first order term. So essentially, to lowest order, you just get lambda, and then this first order term will be nu, which is the density of states, ln squared, and then you get a log of some cutoff, okay, over t, and then higher order terms. Okay, so nu is the density of states. And d is a UV cutoff. And in condensed matter physics, you can take the bandwidth. Okay. And so this correction explains the experimental result. So that's what Kondo wanted, and so everybody is very impressed. But you know, what happens if So what happens, you know, obviously when there's at some place perturbation theory is going to break down because this term will be of the same order as that term, okay? And that happens at some scale which is called the Kondo temperature, which will be the cutoff times e to the minus I, one, sorry, over mu times lambda. So this is the Kondo temperature. And so actually you can calculate the beta function and at one loop it will be d lambda by d, and you find that this is minus nu, which is a positive quantity, L lambda squared. Okay, so the beta function is negative. So this should remind you of QCD, which is also a theory which has a negative beta function. I have another blackboard here. Okay, oops, sorry. And okay, so you can actually sum up perturbation theory, and you find an effective coupling. And so this will be lambda over 1 minus nu lambda ln d naught over d. And So if lambda is bigger than zero, which is the so-called anti-ferromagnetic case, it means that this lambda effective of D diverges when the scale reaches this Kondo temperature. And this is d naught times e to the minus I nu lambda. Okay, so so essentially perturbation theory breaks down. At TK. And this means actually you can show that you have a strongly coupled fixed point in the IR actually in this case. So, but the main point I wanted to make, if the situation is similar to QCD, and essentially this TK you can identify with lambda or QCD. Okay, and so essentially we have a renormalization group flow from a UV to an IR fixed point. Yes. Can I have six because there was the announcement of the hiking trip? Okay. Okay. So essentially the Kondo model has, so there is a strongly coupled RG fixed point in the IR. Okay, and so we start in the UV, where we just have the free theory, and then we switch on this operator, this one, okay, and that operator is actually marginally irrelevant, so it drives you out of this to some other fixed point. And that's where the interesting strong coupling physics happens. And essentially what happens here is, so in the IR, the impurity spin forms a singlet with the electron spin and so essentially your new ground state will look like something like this, 1 over square root 2 impurity up, electron down, minus impurity down, electron up, and so there's some screening. Okay, so, and this is also very similar to what we have in QCD, and so it's a bit like compared to mesons in QCD. So in the UV, you have your impurity spin, and then there's lots of electron spins pointing in various directions. And then in the IR, they all align such that when you are outside some region, you cannot see this anymore. Okay, and then this is a screening process. And okay, and now the UV and IR, of course, correspond to conformal field theories. And you can, so this is just the free fermionic conformal field theory. And here there is a shift of the boundary condition, because if you have this state, ground state, it will cost energy to add another electron to the same position of the impurity. And this means you will have anti-symmetric boundary conditions. Here in this picture. Okay, so let me just quickly write this down before I finish. Okay, so the fixed points are described by CFTs, two-dimensional CFTs, and so the UV is just a free theory, and in the IR, it costs energy to put a further electron at r equal to 0. And this means you have to impose some anti-symmetric boundary conditions. And so essentially, this means that the right movers at zero will be equal to minus the left movers at zero. Okay, so this means from the point of view of conformal field theory that you have a boundary CFT, and there's a different gluing conditions at this boundary. So essentially, you completely got rid of the interaction and just traded it for some boundary conditions at the fixed point. And so there's this whole story. We can write a Katz-Moody algebra for this current and then glue the representations in different ways. And there's some very, very beautiful conformal field theory, mostly due to Affleck and Ludwig and in the 90s. And so, however, what I will do tomorrow essentially is first of all, we are interested in large N. Now, the large N limit of this model also has been considered by condensed matter physicists a long time ago, and I should name two persons, Piers Kugelmann, and the other one is Nathan André. So this is also already in the 80s, and especially because we use this Averikoso of pseudo-fermions, which I mentioned earlier, in the large N limit, then this model actually will start to look like a superconductor. This is what I want to show you, to you tomorrow. And then I will show you how you can construct a holographic model for this. Again, using brains. So you need fields in the fundamental. These chi's, which I rubbed off, they will be in the fundamental representation of the spin symmetry. So you need some extra probe brains. And then we will write down a simple toy model, which we can solve, and then, for instance, calculate the spectral functions, which can then be compared to something for quantum dots, for instance. So that's the plan for tomorrow. Thank you very much. Yeah?
In one plus one is the Hamiltonian variety, only one has.
Okay, here I'm choosing just one, but you can introduce several channels, okay, so you can have a kind of flavor symmetry, which in condensed matter physics is called a channel symmetry. So then you can have a Kac-Moody algebra which has a K, N, and N. So the N with the spin symmetry will be the N, and the K level of the Kac-Moody, yeah. So, but here I'm keeping simple, and there's only one channel, one flavor. But you can have more, but then the model becomes more complicated. Well, okay, so I didn't really show you in detail. I mean, you can just see that essentially what happens at the fixed point is that you get the same theory as before, except that the boundary condition changes. Okay, so there nothing changes really for the electrons except at this position where x is equal to zero, and so then in that sense you have screening, but it's a strongly coupled IR fixed point. So this you can study this within conformal field theory to show actually that this is a true IR fixed point. So in that sense it's different from QCD, but the similarity is that the beta function is negative and you have the screening behavior. Well, there's a screening between electrons and this impurity, okay? So the electrons screen the impurity. I mean, among themselves, at so far, the electrons are just free. I mean, the only thing which happens is at this where the impurity sits. Okay. Well, okay, you can think of it as there's something called the Kondo cloud. So there's a cloud forming around this this impurity, and which corresponds to the screening, and you can ask how much extended this is. But really, the important physics happens at the position of the impurity. Yes, I think so, because so Wilson actually, this was one of the first examples where he actually applied the RG2, and this model was actually very decisive for Wilson to develop the RG. So as I said, I mean, this model was developed just for explaining an experimental fact, but it really became very important in the development of quantum field theory, especially for the whole RG story. And yeah, Wilson solved this model using the RG, essentially. Okay, very good. So see you tomorrow. Yeah, well, the double trace will come because tomorrow. So far I didn't take large n. So now when you take large n,
yeah.
then you can write for large n.
Sorry. Larger, you mean only straight to the Fermi goes to larger, but to the this
Bindi
back also, then it.
I'm sorry. So then you have this, and then the large n is an n goes infinity. Then this becomes. And this is double trace.
Not just an.
So yeah, these are
Gaussian variables. Yeah. So this is
for GD. Yeah, because here you can use the fields, and then if you multiply these two things together, use the
Sorry, I'm a little confused about this. This is the M particle. I mean,
the electrons.
And this is called the defect.
Yeah, this is the defect.
And this is double trace.
Yeah, this is double trace.
For me, it's more like the boundary. I mean, the boundary can bound field theory. It seems we add in some defect and to observe the system in a large field, then it goes to another boundary condition.
Yeah, but here you can really study the entire RG flow.
go to the IR.
Yeah.
And this operator drives you out of the point.
Yeah.
Okay, so then here we can study much more. I mean, it will be large n, but we can study the entire algebra, not just the fixed points.
Well, what confused me is that the double trace of, I mean, the algebra flow for this double trace operator is a Clark integral. I mean, the Clark term. I mean, in the field theory, we couple the theory with a double trace operator in the bark, and then it flows to another.
This is the double trace operator. So you also have the double trace with the only n equals to 4 theory. You have twice pi squared. Okay, and that's the rule to solve the field supergravity theory.
Yes.
Here it's very similar, but these fields are the fundamentals, so you don't need to write a trace. But this operator is a field theory operator, but the double trace is also a field theory.
And no, he was mentioning this is only acting on that x, and this is usually the integrate of x. That's what he means.
Not necessarily.
Yeah,
you don't have to.
Yeah.
That's one question.
Yeah.
I'm not very convinced about that there's an IR fixed part. Because here we have wonderful, we have a better function up to lambda square, right? Negative.
Yeah.
So if you can, there's a fixed point, you mean if you could have been able to introduce higher order things, then there's a positive term, then you make it
there's
a fixed point. So it seems like for higher order corrections, there's a positive contribution for example, to the lambda to the fourth.